अस्सलाम वालेकुम, आप लोगों को आवाज आ रही है मेरी? हाँ जी स्टूडेंट्स, आपको आवाज आ रही है? हेलो, हेलो, आवाज आ रही है आप लोगों को मेरी? हेलो, 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 आप लोगों को आवाज आ रही है मेरी? हाँ जी, आवाज आ रही है अब आप लोगों को? हेलो, हेलो, हेलो जी स्टूडेंट्स, हेलो, हाँ
मैडम आ रही
जी
है आवाज
आ रही
अभी।
है। चलो गुड, ओके। तो क्या हाल चाल है आप लोगों का? सारे ठीक है? और टेस्ट का एक्सपीरियंस कैसा था आप लोगों का?
मैसी क्यों का नहीं, वो आपने मेंशन नहीं किया हुआ था पहले,
वो
कैसी
एक्चुअली
कैसी
वही वाली बात है कि आई डू अंडरस्टैंड के बिकॉज दिस इज अ न्यू एक्सपीरियंस इवन फॉर अस एज वेल, और बिल्कुल फ्रेंकली के हमें ये सारा जो मूडल का फॉर्मेट था इसको खुद ही समझना पड़ा, नोबडी गाइडेड अस। सो वो ये चीज आई डू अंडरस्टैंड के हुआ, लेकिन ये कि जिन्होंने एक दो ने किए ठीक, उन्होंने काफी होगा कि आपके मार्क्स उन्होंने कहीं उन्हें 5 भी लिए हैं, लेकिन ये कि उससे मुझे ये भी अंडरस्टैंडिंग हुई कि आप लोगों को क्वेश्चन समझने में भी टाइम लगता है। दिस आई आल्सो अंडरस्टूड के उसको भी हमें इसके ऊपर वर्क करना है। सो उसमें ये है कि मेरा ख्याल है कि आपको अगले या तो मूडल पे ही मैं टेस्ट दे दूंगी एसईक्यूज का ही 3-4, ताकि आपको एटलीस्ट उनको अंडरस्टैंडिंग और उनकी राइटिंग फॉर्मेट आपके लिए वो आसान हो जाए। तो बाकी ये कि आप लोगों के एमसीक्यूज में से कुछ बहुत बेसिक्स ऐसे थे जो आप लोगों ने गलत किए, और क्योंकि वो ये जो मूडल है व्हाट इट डज इज कि ये क्वेश्चन शफल कर देता है। सो जो हो सकता है कि लेट्स सी एसएन के पास जो आ रहा हो क्वेश्चन फॉर्मेट पेपर का 1, 2, 3, 4 वो डिफरेंट हो फ्रॉम लेट्स से अली के पास जो आ रहा है। सो उसमें ये सारे क्वेश्चंस को वन बाय वन ही शायद डील करना पड़े, तो आप लोगों के साथ अंडरस्टैंडिंग हो या आप चाहें तो उसके लिए क्लास नेक्स्ट क्लास कर लें ईद के बाद, या अगर आप समझते हैं कि उनमें से जो कोई मुश्किल क्वेश्चंस थे वो मैं आपके साथ कोई उस पे आई डोंट नो कि किस तरह इसको शेयर करूं मूडल पे, दिस मुझे ये नहीं पता कि आप लोग उसको कैसे अंडरस्टैंड करते हैं। सो थोड़ी सी टेक्निकल इश्यूज हैं आई अंडरस्टैंड कि ये हमारी तरफ से भी आ रहे हैं। सो होप फॉर द बेस्ट कि हम चीजों को करेंगे। सो टुडेज टॉपिक इज पर्पिरल डिसऑर्डर्स एंड दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक बिकॉज राइट आफ्टर प्रेगनेंसी डिलीवरी देन देयर कम्स अ थर्ड फेज व्हिच कम्स विद अ लॉट ऑफ चैलेंजेस, कि जिसमें जो है एक तो जो एक मटर्नल फिजियोलॉजी है वो एक टेक्स अ डिफरेंट डायरेक्शन, एज वेल एज द मदर हैज नाउ टू टेक केयर, फिजिकली टेक केयर ऑफ द बेबी। सो उसकी वजह से देर आर सम फिजियोलॉजिकल चेंजेस एंड एज वेल एज देर आर सम कॉम्प्लिकेशंस व्हिच अकर इन दिस। हाँ जी, पपीरम को डिफाइन कैसे करते हैं, किसी को आइडिया है? इट इज द 6 वीक्स व्हिच अकर आफ्टर द डिलीवरी और दिस थर्ड स्टेज ऑफ लेबर और डिलीवरी ऑफ द प्लेसेंटा एंड द बेबी इफ इट अकर्स इन द सिजेरियन सेक्शन। सो जो चेंजेस इसमें ज्यादा द चेंजेस इन्वॉल्व इन इट आर द यूट्राइन इन्वोल्यूशन, बिकॉज वी ऑल नो दैट इन फुल टर्म प्रेगनेंसी द यूट्रस मे गो अप टू अ साइज ऑफ 40 सेंटीमीटर्स। देन देर आर जेनिटल ट्रैक चेंजेस बिकॉज इन नॉर्मल डिलीवरी the baby passes through the birth canal and there are a lot of changes in the cervix as well as in the vagina as well as in the perineal area. Then lochia, which is the discharge or the bleeding which occurs post delivery and which is basically sloughed off endometrium, and then breastfeeding. So these are the basic four physiological changes that occur right after the delivery of the baby and the period of puerperium starts. So we are going to discuss one by one all these changes. The genital tract after delivery, we observe that the uterus is enlarged, flabby, cervix is soft, and the that is right after the delivery, the lochia or the sloughed of endometrium is red in color. But then gradually all these changes, they revert to what was pre-pregnancy state. So first of all is uterine involution. Uterine involution is very important because if there is a delay in uterine involution, there may be a chance of severe hemorrhage or bleeding. So what happens is that very gradually the uterus from size of the umbilicus or at the level of umbilicus, it starts to reduce in size, and within 2 weeks it becomes almost the same size which was pre-pregnancy. And that is from the abdominal organ, it then becomes a pelvic organ again. And after 2 weeks, it resorts its normal pelvic position. And if there is a delay or if we can palpate a uterus after 2 weeks, here 2 weeks after the delivery, that means the uterine involution has not taken place, and this may alarm us that this patient is at risk of certain complications like postpartum hemorrhage, or this patient can have endometritis, etc. So what are the causes? The causes are full bladder. Sometimes the patient has problem in voiding, so the bladder remains full or it's incompletely voided, and as a result, even the uterus cannot involute properly to regain its normal or pre-pregnancy state. Then full rectum. Uterine infection, very important, especially in those deliveries which are not conducted by experienced person, they may cause certain infection in the uterus. Then retained products of conception is very important, that there may be some placental pieces or membranes which remain, and as a result the uterus never regains its normal or pre-pregnancy state. Then there may be fibroids in the uterus, that is why the uterus remains enlarged in size, and maybe a certain bleeding like a broad ligament hematoma which may occur even during normal delivery. So these are the signs, abnormal signs of puerperium, that the uterus has not reducing in size gradually. Then there are genital tract changes and lochia, and these are vaginal discharges. There are three type of vaginal discharges, and in a total it takes 5 to about 6 weeks. So vaginal discharge in the first 1 to 2 weeks is red in color, and this is known as lochia rubra, and that may be, may persist in 15% of women up to 6 weeks postpartum. So this is normal as long as there are no other signs. And then it is lochia serosa. From rubra it then gradually changes into serosa, which is that brownish red, it is more watery in consistency, and then the overall discharge amount continues to decrease, and in the end is a yellow color, which is lochia alba, and after that the uterine involution becomes completed. आपको मेरी स्क्रीन नजर आ रही है? हाँ जी, स्क्रीन नजर आ रही है आप लोगों को मेरी?
यस मैम, आ रही है।
अच्छा ठीक है, मैं लिटिल गेट कंफ्यूज्ड क्योंकि पॉज शेयर हो जाता है और समटाइम्स वो मुझे ऐसे लगता है कि आप उनको आ रही है, प्लीज मुझे बता दिया करें। सो देन देयर कम्स द प्रीनियल कॉम्प्लिकेशंस। these basically they are the complications which occur during the vaginal delivery or the vaginal birth, and perineal discomfort is one of the main concerns or complaints post vaginal delivery. And about 80% of the women, they complain of severe pain in the perineum after delivery, and because of that pain there may be problem in voiding of the urine, as well as in sitting, even standing. So they have severe pains because of that. So they occur because of certain perineal tears, which may occur during delivery or episiotomies. So they may be stitched badly, or because of the techniques that use is not very good. And sometimes women may feel very pain, severe pain because of the episiotomy. And if the instruments have been implied, like forceps or vacuum during the delivery, they may cause extra damage or trauma to the perineal area. And so the local area becomes damaged and the patient feels more pain. So how to treat with it? We advise the patient to have local cooling, like use crushed ice or witch hazel. Local anesthetics may be used, like xylocaine gel are advised. Or then if the pain is more, then you can even advise painkillers or analgesics to the patient. Then bladder dysfunction is also one of the very common complaints. And this may be due to urinary retention, which is because of the perineal pain, as I already discussed. Maybe because of a complication of epidural anesthesia, in which the patient feels, it does not feel that bladder is full, and then she cannot void. Bladder becomes atonic. Then oxytocin release, because oxytocin has an antidiuretic effect, so that may cause problem. Postpartum diuresis itself is a complication. Sometimes it does occur because the woman has a desire or increased frequency of micturition. If she's taking a lot of fluid, again, that will cause a problem. Then traumatic vaginal delivery, again, there will be a lot of trauma to the perineal area, even to the urethral area. And the patient may feel pain and will avoid emptying the bladder. Then painful hemorrhoids, which may occur during pregnancy and become worsened after the delivery. Anal fissures and full rectum, or sometimes because of the mismanaged vaginal delivery or even cesarean section, there may be a fistula. That is, a communication develops between the vaginal wall and the bladder. And hence, there is a continuous dribble of the urine, and the woman then just loses her control over the bladder functions. So how do you manage the bladder functions? You minimize the perineal pain, encourage the bladder emptying. It's very important that the more she keeps the bladder full, the more likely chances that she will get infected. On examination, one can even palpate the bladder or even visualize it under the ultrasound, that the bladder is full despite voiding, or we can find out the post-voiding ultrasound, ask the patient to void, and even if the bladder is filled more than 10 to 15%, that means she is not voiding completely. Then we may have to catheterize the patient to at least give her the relief of these all these complications, and have a look at the amount of urine that is producing, and even the color, maybe it is red or there is some bladder injury, etc. Then send for urine microscopy and culture. And if the patient is incontinent, one must rule out fistula, because the early the fistula is detected, the higher chances of it to be repaired successfully by surgery. Urinary tract infection is very common, even in normal vaginal deliveries as well as in the cesarean sections. So the risk factors are C-section. Even doing catheterization to a patient, we can introduce infections. Forceps delivery, vacuum delivery, induction of labor means if we are putting cervical catheters, or we are introducing certain inducing medicines vaginally, they may cause infection. And maternal renal diseases which may be pre-existing and they become worsened after the delivery. Another problem that may occur are the bowel dysfunctions. Bowel dysfunctions are again because of constipation, and the constipation can be because of dehydration, that the woman is taking less of fluid, and even after the delivery there is a certain hormonal changes which may affect the bowel function as well. Then perineal pain itself will prevent the patient from defecation. So you need to treat it with increased fluid intake, pain relief, and high fiber diet. Now, postpartum hemorrhage is the most important factor that we should always keep in mind. We all know that this is defined as an excessive bleeding loss during or after the third stage of labor, and usually the average blood loss is 500 ml. But this one thing that I want you to be very clear, that this 500 ml is the amount of blood loss that is sustained by a patient or a woman who had HB of 11 10 or 11. So if a patient already had an HB of, let's say, 7 or 8, so losing a blood of even 200 ml is going to be very harmful to her. So 500 ml average is the amount of bleeding that can be sustained by a woman who had a normal hemoglobin level. But the hemoglobin level of a patient, if they are low, even the less blood loss can be harmful to the patient. So the postpartum hemorrhage can be a primary or it can be a secondary. The primary occurs in the first 24 hours after the delivery, and the secondary occurs 1 to 2 weeks and even up till 6 weeks after the delivery. So that means that the puerperium is a period where the women can have certain complications within those period of 6 weeks anytime. What are the causes of postpartum hemorrhage? They result from uterine atony, we all know. Then again, low genital tract infections, retained products of conception, uterine rupture may go undiagnosed, if especially normal delivery, which she had a previous cesarean section, she delivered, and there may be a rupture which may have been diagnosed later on. Then uterine inversion is very common, that the uterus becomes upside down and the fundus of the uterus starts coming out. This is also very dire emergency, obstetrical emergency. Placenta accreta, that means a part of the placenta may have been adherent at the placental site. Coagulopathy and hematoma, that is collection of blood. So they are all causes of postpartum hemorrhage, which may present in as a primary as well as a secondary postpartum hemorrhage. Lower genital tract lacerations or damages that occurs again from the obstetrical trauma or trauma during the childbirth because of the use of or injudicious or unskilled use of forceps or vacuums, and other predisposing factors are the macrosomia of the baby, that the baby is bigger in size and it comes out, it may cause more damage or lacerations to the vaginal wall as well as to the perineum, and episiotomy if it has not been given in a proper way. Then comes infection of the uterus or endometritis. The risk factors are C-sections, the patient is young, emergency cesarean section, diabetes mellitus, prolonged labor, and prolonged rupture of membrane. That the patient, if antenatally she had a rupture of membranes for, let's say, over 2 weeks, there is a chance that there may be already a subclinical uterine infection or endometrial infection which may become overt after the delivery. So there are all risk factors. Another is a wound infection. The wounds can be of two types, after the vaginal delivery or cesarean section. So vaginal delivery, the wound can be infected because of infected lochia or fecal contamination if the patient is not hygienically educated or she has a poor hygiene or then cesarean section, there are a lot of risk factors like diabetes, hypertension, obesity, corticosteroid treatments, immunosuppression. She's anemic, there is issue of prolonged labor, prolonged rupture of membranes, prolonged operating time, abdominal twin delivery, all these add to the factors of having infection in the wound or cesarean section wound infection and excessive blood loss. Because all, if you read all these factors, you will understand that basically all these factors, they come under heading of less HB, less immunity, and having prone to infection. ये तीन headings में ये बाकी ये सारी जो मैंने आपको बताई ये आ जाती हैं. Because if the HB is less, as in anemia, excessive blood loss, or prone to infection, like in prolonged labor, prolonged rupture of membranes, diabetes mellitus, immunosuppression, they all these factors they come under these headings. So these patients have a likely chance of having wound infection. Then comes a certain rare problems like obstetric palsy, in which the patient suddenly she is unable, she has severe pain in the limbs and she is unable to move or stand, and because there is a compression or herniation of lumbosacral disc, usually occurs after delivery because of the posture and the posture of the baby head. So for that we need to have an orthopedic consult, and the case may be handed over to the orthopedic surgeon. Another is pubic symphysis diastasis, in which there the normal distance between the two pubic bone that a little increases, and the balance of the pelvis or pelvic bone is disturbed. Again, this is a very painful and discomfort condition, and even this needs to have be treated by rest and by the consult of orthopedics. Another very important complication that may occur is a thromboembolism. That is, the we all know that pregnancy is a thromboembolic state, and that state continues even after the delivery. So the patient has a 5 times increased risk, more increased risk of having thromboembolism in pregnancy as in puerperium. So majority of deaths in puerperium, they are sudden deaths, they occur because of thromboembolism. And if there is deep venous thrombosis, we may have to start with the proper anticoagulant therapy, but again with the consult of a physician. Then comes the puerperal pyrexia, that is a fever during delivery, after the delivery. So there is a significant rise of temperature of more than 38 degrees centigrade on any of the two, either in the first 10 days puerperium, but we should exclude the first 24 hours. And the common sites because of the common causes of puerperal pyrexia may be again due to the infection in the genital tract, in the infection of endometrium, infection in the breast, or even chest, legs, or anything. So we need to see the what is the cause of puerperal pyrexia. So I'm going a little quickly. Chest complications, we know that there may be atelectasis, especially, or RDS or Mendelssohn syndrome, especially the women who are going cesarean sections. Or genital tract infection, I have already told you what are the risk factors, what are the organisms. They are usually beta hemolytic streptococcus, staphylococcus epidermidis, and peptostreptococcus. These are all normal sometimes, or abnormal commensals, or their flora. The balance between the flora is changed because of the trauma that happens during the delivery. So these are the risk factors for puerperal infection. Again, the antenatal intrauterine infection, the patient was already infected for certain disease, cesarean section, prolonged rupture of membranes, prolonged labor, instrumental delivery, manual removal of placenta, and detailed products of conception. If this is the history there is a likely chance that this patient will have problem. So breast disorders, again, the patient will have painful nipples, or she will have problem in breastfeeding. That because of that, she may suffer from high grade fever. The most important thing is the contraception. The contraception is very important. Usually it is stated that the breastfeeding provides a normal contraception. Well, that is not very correct, because it may help, but maybe in 60 to 70% of the women. But rest may need, rest of the patient may need a definite method of contraception, and that we need to decide with the consent of the patient. In the end, are the psychiatric disorders, they are very important, we may overlook, but they affect about 80% of the women. May not be harmful, they may be normal physiological changes, like in postnatal pinks, occur in 24 to 48 hours, a little bit of excitement, mood elevation, insomnia, and then blues come when the women feels fatigued, there's depression, fearfulness, or tearfulness, and usually it subsides spontaneously. However, whenever there are panic attacks, depression for more than 2 weeks, low self-esteem or guilt, hopelessness, suicidal thoughts, or certain biological symptoms like anorexia, insomnia, then these are the patients that need to be referred to psychiatrist immediately, because you need to diagnose these psychiatric disorders early and then involve the psychiatrist, because there are high chance of recurrence, and this is not affecting the patient as well as the baby as well. So it may need to have certain antipsychotic treatments given to the patient. So psychiatric disorders are very important, although as this slide says that they are mostly due to the hormonal changes which occur during, after the delivery, there is fall of estrogens and progesterone. But sometimes because of the pre-existing disorders that the woman is facing, or because of the stress that she goes through the delivery, the hidden psychiatric disorders may become overt in it. So any question or you want to ask? We have little time left, actually. I think 2 minutes only. हाँ जी, सबको सब समझ आ गई है. Okay, I am going to put up an SCQ test on Moodle. उसके लिए टाइम आप मुझे बता दें कि मैं आपको किसी भी इवनिंग का दे दूं या क्या दे दूं. सुनाई दे रहा आप लोगों को? Okay, since nobody is answering me, I think it's time to stop. On the gynecology WhatsApp group, अगर आप लोग चाहते हैं कि मैं आपके SCQs का कोई टेस्ट लूँ, तो प्लीज मुझे उसमें शेयर कर दें, टेस्ट टाइम शेयर कर दें मॉड्यूल के ऊपर. I'll put up few questions so that you will understand or you will know how to answer the SCQs, because the SCQ part of yours, all of most of you is quite poor, because you don't understand the questions. Very important that you understand the question and then write the answers. So since nobody is answering me and the time is over, I expect you to answer me or tell me so that I may work in that direction which is helpful to all of you. So all the best Eid Mubarak to all of you, and take care of yourself and your family.